The Bible calls us ambassadors of Christ. Amen.
Amen.
If you're born again, you're an ambassador for Christ. That means you represent Him. And then representing God means you speak for Him, you talk for Him. Okay? Now, for me to talk for God, I must know what God's mind is. For an ambassador to represent the United States, the ambassador must speak the mind of the government. The heart of the, if the ambassador does not know, has not called Washington to get instructions and goes and speaks, you know what would happen? Benghazi. You understand? All the chaos, chaos will come. So as children of God, we must constantly be, because I'm an ambassador of Christ, I must walk in communion with Him. Another thing that makes me different and helps me to be holy is the fact that I am the temple of God. I'm the temple of God. As a young man, this scared me. That scripture, 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 19. He says, you are the temple of God. And he says something about it. He goes on to say in that text that because you are the temple of God, anyone who defiles the temple of God, what will God do to that person? God will destroy them. That scared me. Praise the name of the Lord. Now thank God for His mercy. I'm still alive. Amen. Amen. I made it this far. Hallelujah. And I made up my mind no longer to do those things that I used to do. God gave me the chance and He gave me the opportunity to get things right with Him. A holy God cannot dwell in the midst of filth. A holy God cannot dwell in the midst of dirt and filth. Because God is a holy God and I'm His temple. That means, that's why the Bible says that we should renew our minds. He says we should separate ourselves to Him. That's why He challenges us to do that, because He's a holy God, and this holy God will dwell in purity and dwell in holiness. I am the temple of the Holy Spirit. If you're born again, you become the temple of God. God said, I will dwell in them. I will make my abode with them. Now, this is one of those things that I've realized. If God is in me or with me, or in me particularly, if God dwells in me, no other power, no other force can dwell in me.
Amen.
If God is in me, I've never seen a fly on a hot stove. Have you seen it before? Let the fly come near the hot stove. If God is in you, no other power or thing can afflict you.
Amen.
Nothing else can dwell in where God is. So no matter what it is, even to help yourselves and to help your families, what you can do is just begin. Even if they don't know Christ, just begin to invite Jesus Christ into their homes. Invite Jesus Christ. Every time you go to see, visit your cousin, say, Lord, as I go into this house, let your presence come into this house. Because as you're inviting the presence of God into those homes, God is cleansing. God will purify. And you pray for His mercy as you invite His presence, because sometimes they don't mess up about that. But you pray for the mercy of God, amen? You say, let your presence purify. Because you carry the presence, and as you go, the presence of God will go with you. And the presence of God will bring encouragement, will bring healing, will bring deliverance, will bring hope, will bring joy. Are you with me? Praise the name of the Lord. What makes us different? We are born again. What makes us different? We represent Christ. What makes us different? We are the temple of the Holy Spirit. That's what makes us holy, makes us different. And then we must constantly be aware and walk in the reality of this. Now, very quickly, what are those signs that a person has this divine DNA of holiness? What are those things that you see in the person that tells you that this person is growing in this divine holiness of divine DNA of holiness? The first thing you see in Hebrews chapter 12, from verse 9 to 11, it talks about, you know, one of those things. If those who have this nature are willing to be corrected, they are willing to be taught, they are willing to accept correction, they are willing to accept and to yield to God, they are willing and quick to obey the voice of God. If I don't have the divine DNA, no matter who talks to me, I will not listen. If I don't have the divine DNA, I'll be even difficult to talk, to be taught rather. Any man that tells me the nature of God. I heard about a pastor years ago, he's gone on to be with the Lord now. He was a servant of God. But he would not listen to anybody. He preached the gospel, was very, very successful, he would not listen to anybody. God sent one of his children who has also gone to be with the Lord to go talk to him. He actually held a meeting for him. And the reason why God sent him there was to talk to him so that maybe he would listen and he would learn and then he would be healed. And he died at 43 years old. After about almost 2 weeks of this man being there, he didn't have this guy himself that invited this other person, didn't come for any of the meetings, any of the weekday meetings. He didn't show up because he was very busy. He didn't show up at all. And he kept talking to him. Finally, when he had the chance to sit down and talk with him, he sat down and talked with him. I told him, you know, do you know why God asked me to come here? He said, yeah, you have the word of God. God wants my people to hear what you're teaching and what you're teaching is true. And he told him, God sent you to tell me this. I came here saying, you know, if you listen and you practice it, you will not die. He said, I know, but I'd rather die than admit that I'm wrong. That's what he said. And the man who told him, the moment he said that, God said to him, 1 week from now, Sunday, you'll be dead. And exactly that, he was dead at 43. Because he was not willing to be taught. And he was successful. He would have still been here today. But he's gone. The truth is this, those who have the divine DNA, or proof of having the divine DNA, is your willingness to be taught, your willingness to obey, your willingness to yield. The Bible says the wisdom that is from above is first peaceful, that it yields. The Bible says, I have the way, it's just me. Read James. Read the book of James, you see what I'm talking about. Praise the name of the Lord. So, quick way to know is that person willing to be taught? Is that person willing to yield? Is that person quick to obey? Now, what steps can I take to help me to be different, to help me to be holy? And I shared the first one with us last week. And I said, you must have an accountability partner. Remember that? Everybody needs to have an accountability partner. Somebody you talk to. You know, somebody you share with. Somebody you can confess to. Somebody you can open your heart to. Everybody should have an accountability partner. If you don't have anyone you're accountable to, then you're exposed, you're on your own. And that means they are not willing to be taught. And that means you're working this dangerous path. The quality of the divine DNA is the willingness to live by God. You must be accountable. You must be accountable. That's one. Number two, you must be under authority. Some people have heard people say, you know what, I don't need to go to any church. If I need to hear a message or anyone, I can watch TV. Now, I'd be a great hope. No, I watch Bishop T.D. Jakes on here, but are you in Bishop T.D. Jakes' church? Are you submitted to his authority? Are you following the directions he gives to the flock that God has sent him to pastor? Is he pastoring you from 3,000 miles? Are you with me? He must be under authority. Anyone who is not under authority is not submitted to walking in the path of holiness. Holiness demands you must be under authority. It is a fact of the scriptures. You must be under authority. Then number three, you must live daily. Live daily. Tell somebody, live daily. Live daily. Like, you know, live one day at a time. Live daily. Live one moment at a time for the Lord. Live each day, daily for the Lord. What do I mean? Don't worry about what tomorrow will be like. This actually was a revelation and a deliverance for me. And I just, you know, for years I would struggle and struggle. And then when I heard, you don't need to worry about all that. You just win the battles of today. Just win today. And I'll tell myself, today, I just need to live right today. That's it. And I make it through each day. Like that. The next day I wake up, I just need to live right today. Not tomorrow. Don't worry about it. Oh, you're feeling like this today. overcome it today. I'm not concerned about what happens tomorrow. Let me overcome this today. You're feeling that, let me overcome that temptation just today. Don't be concerned about tomorrow. Once you overcome today, you know what happens to you? Tomorrow you get, and then you overcome again today. As long as it's day, victory comes day by day, moment by moment. Praise the name of the Lord. Amen. What steps to take? Live each day for the Lord. Overcome each day. Overcome your mind. You know, focus your mind on being victorious today. Number four, avoid situations that increase your propensity for temptations or your exposure to temptations. Avoid situations that expose you more to temptations. I give you examples. If you have problems with money, okay, you know, you don't manage money well. You don't manage money well. You spend money when every time you see it, you spend, and you're always in budget trouble. You join a group and they say you're going to be the treasurer. You tell them, no, I don't need this one to be. You tell them, you don't need to tell them the reason, but you just tell them, no, you don't need to be that treasurer. Because if you become a treasurer, you're going to, you have not overcome the temptation, and you're exposing yourself to what will expose you to greater temptation. You see, for instance, you have a problem of staying focused. You know, when you get, you know, you sit down on the computer, you get this spam about whatever, you click the link, and you begin from one link, you go to another link. Then, take your computer and put it right there where everybody else can see you. Are you with me?
Yes.
Put it where anybody and everybody can see you. Don't work on your computer in the dark, in the secret, because when you do, you will expose yourself to more temptation. Are you with me?
Yes.
As a practical step. You know, you get angry. You get angry when people do certain things. You know, when things are not done a certain way, you get angry. You know. And you know that no matter what this, when you come to church, you will see a piece of paper on the floor, it will get you angry. So when you are coming to church, before you start coming to church, you just say, Lord, I will not be angry. I'm going to church to rejoice. And as you are coming in, you say, and every paper that I see, I'm going to make you well. Because the moment you feel like that, and you make up your mind to be the correction, you will not get angry. Are you with me?
Yes.
Praise the name of the Lord. Yes. And if there are people who make you upset, they get on your nerves all the time, and you know them, that every time I see the sister, she just says something or does something. You know what you should do? This is how you get over that. Every morning, every day as you pray, you say, Father, I pray for Sister Julie. Let your glory cover her. Let your beauty surround her. Every time I see Sister Julie, joy will flow from her heart. And when you see Sister Julie, you will see, you will be smiling. But if you know that Sister Julie upsets you, and you don't do anything, anytime you're seeing how you just avoid that. I say you don't avoid that. You know, there's some people you avoid, it's going to be okay. But there's some people you act like you don't see, you have just started. You're in trouble. Amen?
Amen.
So avoid those situations that will get you into things that will expose you more to temptation. Praise the name of the Lord.
Amen.
Avoid it. That's why it's good to have an accountability partner. And when you fail, if you fail, talk quickly, turn around quickly. Give a call to your accountability partner. Pray, come to God and say, God, have mercy on me. When you do that, you establish a culture, a pattern of holiness, and you set yourself up for success and for pleasing the Lord as He desires for you. Are you with me? Praise the name of the Lord. Okay, praise the name of the Lord. So what is the nature of God like? God's nature is holy. His nature is holy. I want to go on very quickly. What is God's nature like? Talked about the holiness of God. God's nature is giving. His nature is giving. He has a giving nature. So I want to talk about the generosity of God. The generosity of God. It's the DNA of God to be generous, to give.
The generosity of God. Giving is natural to God. It's in his DNA, it's part of the instruction that he passes to his children. When you see in Genesis chapter 1, from the very beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. And God made everything beautiful. He created the things that are in the waters, on the air, on the land. And after he looked at everything, he said from verse 26, let us make man in our image and after our likeness, and let man have dominion. And he went on to say, I have given you everything. God created everything, and then he gave it to man. And he said, I prepared this for you to come into it. God is a giving God. His nature is to give. When he called Abraham, he called him and he gave him a promise. He gave him a promise of a family. He gave him a covenant. God gave Abraham a promise, a covenant, a family. And you see, Abraham in Genesis 15 asked him and said, God, what will you give to me, seeing that I've walked with you, seeing that I've obeyed you, I've left my country just like you said, and there's nobody in my house but this man who is my son, and he's going to inherit everything I have. I'm almost 100 years old, and God said, that man is not going to inherit everything in your house. I'm going to give you a child. You're going to have your